Oh, we're so excited to be here. It's wonderful. Not only is this our international premiere, this is our actually world premiere. We're so fortunate to have gotten into FrightFest, and then on the heels of it, we got UK distribution. It comes out September 25th. And then, of course, it's coming out in the United States on October 16th. So we're not doing a lot of festivaling, so this is it. So the story, in a quick sort of bird's eye view, is about a young man who comes back from serving overseas in the war, and he comes back to his family hunting trip, which is they go boar hunting in the Florida Everglades every year. And on this particular trip, when they get out there, they find that their cabin has been predated and smashed, and shortly thereafter, they're all starting to be hunted one by one. And we don't know if our young man that's come back from overseas has come home with a dark secret and he's somehow responsible or not. It's Zane Holtz, who's, you know, the lead on From Dusk Till Dawn. And I discovered Zane, because he wasn't on that show. I discovered him. Of course, Rudy Youngblood, the wonderful Rudy Youngblood from Apocalypto. Jay LaRose from the Insidious series. And Castile Lannon, a really up-and-coming ingenue of an actress. Glenn Powell, who's just going to be a movie star. He's a phenomenal young actor. And Phil Burke, who's one of my dearest friends in the world, who I wrote the role for, who's one of the leads on the AMC TV show called Hell on Wheels. But just a really dynamic, fun, talented group of people. Really exciting. One of the reasons I wanted to write this is I've always been fascinated with indigenous cultures and their mythologies and their mythos. And Windwalkers is kind of my own sort of hybridized version of the myth of the Wendigo, the Wentiko, the Iktomi, the shape-shifting spirit. But the idea was a lot of these indigenous tribes, whether they're to North America or Central or South America, have these stories of these spirits that they've left behind to take redemption and revenge against the white man or for whoever has been colonizing them or taking them away from their natural land. Their people's lands, their tribal lands. And so it's a redemption myth, really, about what happens, essentially, blowback in the spiritual world, you know? And one of the reasons why I wanted to tell this story in the horror genre is I think the horror genre affords us the ability to be shocking, you know? And I think that it's a shame that a lot of horror films aren't political, that a lot of horror films don't use mythology. Some do, but not a lot. And I think it's a really fertile ground. You see it a lot more in political, sci-fi movies than you do in horror films, where they really use political, use it as a forum to state things politically that matters. I mean, we're also in a different world, you know. In the 1970s, you can make a anti-war film like Coming Home or Deer Hunter, and you wouldn't need to have sort of the crossover popcorn appeal for the mainstream audience. But nowadays, it's harder and harder to catch an audience. So this is still, it's still a political movie, it's still an anti-war film, but at the heart of it, it's a horror film. I mean, I think Alien is the one that first comes to mind when you talk about shocking value and subtext, because the Alien, Ridley Scott's version, 1979, is really about a mother. You know, I mean, the mother, Ridley Scott's heroine in Sigourney Weaver, her connection is about saving this child, the new child, from this planet. And what you realize ultimately in the end is that it's Sigourney Weaver as a mother against an alien who's trying to save her own kind. And I really thought that was brilliant, how he brought in sort of this maternalistic fight that culminated in these two species fighting against one another to save their own species. I think horror is oftentimes just unpalatable to mainstream audiences because it's so in your face. And I think that there's not a necessary, I mean, when you look at the classic horror films, The Changeling, when you look at The Shining, when you look at Don't Look Now, when you look at these classic psychological and horror films, they didn't have blood splattering all over the place. They didn't have people cutting off arms. So I think when you ask the pertinent question is, well, what turns people off? My answer is ultimately, when the stories are told well, and that we earn our scares and we earn our castrations, if you will, that people are going to be attracted to them. But when if it's gratuitous and if it's not motivated, I think people not necessarily as excited about it. The next film I'm doing is a psychological thriller with horror elements, kind of like Windwalkers. It's called Woman of the Woods, and I'm shooting that with Lena Headey from Game of Thrones.
Obviously, she's a fantastic actress. What is exciting you the most about getting the chance to work with her?
She's a world-class actress, and you know what's great about Lena is she loves the genre of horror. She is a genre fanatic, and she, you know, got really excited about this particular project, and she wants to sink her teeth into it, for lack of a better metaphor. But that story is really going to be a very personal story about a mother and a daughter, and whether or not the daughter has become haunted by something else that's trying to pull the daughter away from the mother. And so it becomes a family story as well as a haunting supernatural story.
When are you starting production on that? When are we going to get to see that?
We're looking at doing that in February. Yeah. Come see Windwalkers. You're going to learn something, and hopefully we're going to scare the crap out of you.
How's it going? I'm Zane Holtz. I play a character named Kotz in Windwalkers. I've just come back from serving in the military, and I had some experiences there that really troubled me. And I'm bringing that back, and it sort of affects my friends and my family in the sense that this trouble that I have, you don't really know what it is going into the beginning of the film. You think maybe I just had a bad experience. They say he was a prisoner of war. You come to find out throughout the film that his troubles are actually something tangible. It's a creature that has affected his best friend, and it ends up affecting everybody else around him because that creature now wants to consume and hunt his friends and his family. You know, at the time, this was a couple of years ago, I saw it, I met with Russell, I had a meeting with him and Heather, the producer, and they pitched me on the movie, and it seemed like a cool concept. I liked that it kind of blended horror elements with a little bit of action sort of thriller, and I was looking to do some sort of part like that. I thought there was something interesting I could do with the role, and just went for it. Visceral sort of gut reaction that you get from being scared. You know, different movies affect people different ways, but the horror really latches onto that fear part of your psyche, and I think people like to be scared and like to feel that way in a kind of safe environment where, you know, 2 hours later you can walk out of the movie theater.
Is there a particular horror film that had that impact on you?
Yeah, I remember being really, really affected and afraid of The Fly as a kid. Specifically the scene at the end where he throws up on the guy's legs and he starts melting and stuff. It's kind of that body horror stuff has always creeped me out. So that movie really, really had an impact on me. And obviously the movie is so well made. It's great when you can find something in the genre that, you know, is elevated and heightened and you know, it's borderline sci-fi, I guess. I mean, I remember really responding to it.
What does it mean for you to be a part of this year's FrightFest?
It's great, man. It's a great first experience. I have been to London before. I've never been here to sort of promote a movie or anything, so that's a cool first for me. I heard that FrightFest is kind of like the one that you want to be a part of in the horror genre, so I was really excited to be able to come out and support the movie.
Hi, I'm Castilla Landon, and I play Lexi in Windwalkers. So Lexi is the girlfriend of Kotz, who's played by Zane, and she's been waiting for him to come home from war, as women often do, and she has to deal with the person that she fell in love with being a different person than returned to her. And she has to kind of ascertain whether that's because of psychological reasons or supernatural reasons. And dealing with that arc is the whole journey of the character. Heather and Russell. I worked with them on another movie called Ravens, and I love them as people. They're like my parents away from my parents in LA, so any opportunity to work with them is great. And they're so talented, so I knew immediately that it was kind of a no-brainer. We had such a good rapport on set that the difficulty in the film was actually having to, like, step away from all the antics on set and the fun we were having to get in and be like, okay, this is a serious deal and we're killing our friends here, right? That was, yeah, they're great, all of them. It's awesome. I haven't been a part of a horror film festival, but I think it's really cool, and I love being in London, so it's like the best of both worlds. I think that everybody has their niche interests, And I think catering to the niche is really important in today's society. You know, there's so many options to choose from that things get overwhelming. And so it's really nice to have something that is curated specifically for horror fans, as opposed to what studios think horror fans want, you know? And to expose them to expose viewers to things they might otherwise not see. I like all of Alfred Hitchcock's stuff. I'm like an old film junkie. So probably, I mean, if you would consider it horror, like North by Northwest, yeah, that would be my favorite. The scene, the opening scene is just out of control. Right now, I am editing my own feature that I directed and co-wrote called Albion Rise of the Danann. It's a fairy tale for kids, and it stars a 12-year-old little girl and a horse, and then me. So that's taking up all of my time right now, and hopefully that'll be out next year. And then I have a film on Netflix called Sex Ed.
Can you tell us a little bit about Sex Ed?
It's a comedy starring Haley Joel Osment, and actually Glenn Powell's in it too, from this movie. And it's about a virgin who teaches sex ed. It's cute. It's very different from Endwalkers, but it's cool to see, especially because two of us are in it.
Hi, I'm Jay LaRose.
It's fantastic to have you here at FrightFest. What does it mean for you to be a part of this year's festival?
Oh, it means fantastic. First, I'm in London. Whoop, whoop. And, I'm just digging it. You know, I hadn't seen the film before, so I wanted to see it. And, I'm just excited to see what we did. Because we shot this a couple years ago, but and it's a reunion of sorts with all some fellow castmates and the movie makers, and so it's exciting. It's very exciting. I love it. My character is Nealis Kingston, and he's kind of the fatherly, the patriarch of the situation, and a lot of wisdom, I'd like to think, that I bring with it, and he's just feeling like he needs to protect, you know, the people involved in the story, and whether that plays out that way, I don't know. But that's my take on it, is a kind of the protector, and wears the weight of the world on his shoulders. You know, he's kind of put in a position where he knows there's a lot of folklore, a lot of Native American folklore that goes on, and there's certain things that are indicating there might be some bad things happening, and he has to, or his responsibility, he feels, is to decide whether it's really this or really that, and then react accordingly and help protect, you know, the people from the situation as best he can. You know, certain things are out of his hands, but the story is very cool. I really wanted to be a part of it because it kind of gave me an opportunity to. I've been in a bunch of movies. A lot of times I'm killed in glorious fashion, which I love. You know. But I don't get a chance to really flesh out my character, and in this case, I think I got to at least attempt to do some really emotional things, and as an actor, you know, you always want to be able to emote different feelings and expressions, and hopefully sell them, you know, and make them real, and in this case, it gave me a good opportunity to play with that. I guess you're in a, sometimes you have to suspend belief or comfort levels, and hopefully, you know, we make people uncomfortable. In my case, my approach is always, I want to affect somebody, whether it's scare them, make them happy, sad, whatever, but I just want to affect them. I think horror can really dig in a little deeper. We all have certain surface level emotions that we deal with on a daily basis, love, you know, hate, but with horror, I think it digs couple layers deeper into that, and therefore hopefully affects people more, you know, and again that's my goal, is to affect people and best I can. I grew up kind of on the old school horror, you know, Frankenstein when I was a kid, the original stuff, which I love. That stuff I saw with my father, so of course it has a special place in that. Nowadays it's, you know, I think it's the suspense, when the suspense, and for me it's stuff that you can relate to. When something gets too big and over the top, I think sometimes it loses me. But when it's really close to home or easy to imagine identifying with, like a paper cut. You know, we can all imagine paper cuts. So when you start dealing with little cuts like that, to me that kind of bloody horror is most effective. Other than that, just mystery and Yeah, I love ghost stories. I love the supernatural, you know, and so all of that has its play in how I approach or am affected myself by shows and TV and film.
My name is Rudy Youngblood, and I'm playing the character of Manny. Manny is a character that is very disturbed. At the same time, he's losing himself, you know. So at the same time, he's losing his partnership with his friends, his family, and it becomes this chaoticness in his life. At the same time, he's becoming this mythological aspect, right? So with that being said, is now he turns over, but he doesn't understand who he is truly. And at the end of the day, he feels that he's right. So I think it's always a yin and a yang, pull and tug, because he loves and he hates. He loves and he hates. Every day in society, we love and we hate. So with that being said, I guess it's, I think it's just one of those things. It's like, he's still trying to find himself, you know, honestly. Maddie is a character that's is very disturbed. At the same time, he's losing himself, you know. So at the same time, he's losing his partnership with his friends, his family, and it becomes this chaoticness in his life. At the same time, he's becoming this mythological aspect, right? So with that being said, is now he turns over, but he doesn't understand who he is truly. And at the end of the day, he feels that he's right. So I think it's always a yin and a yang, pull and tug, because he loves and he hates. He loves and he hates. Every day in society, we love and we hate. So with that being said, I guess it's, I think it's just one of those things. It's like, he's still trying to find himself, you know, honestly. With Russ, I'm so grateful. Like, when we talked, I asked him, I said, can I have, you know, freedom to create the character? He said, absolutely, I trust you. And with that being said, for a director, it's very rare, but he trusted me. So I honestly, I didn't want to let him down. So I created this character from ground up. And I just wanted to make sure that he gets the bang for his buck, at the same time gets me and what I created. And I hopefully everybody in the world will appreciate it. And hopefully everybody in the world will appreciate Windwalkers, the film in general, because of Russell. So, you know, Russell Friedenberg is he's a great director and a great person. So I would love to work with him again, absolutely. I just think it's the shock of being afraid of something that you don't know or you don't understand. Because we're so secure in our daily lives, but when you get a shock, it intrigues you. So, yeah.
Is there a particular horror film that shocked you, that had that impact on you?
Maybe when I was a kid, it was crazy, because the clown, I don't like clowns. So it's like, no. Yeah, that freaked me out a little bit. Yeah, so. I have never been to FrightFest, and it's fantastic. This is so awesome. I'm in London. How can I complain, first of all? Like, did I say I was in London? Yes, I am in London. It's a 10-hour flight. What the hell? Yes, I am in London. This is fantastic. FrightFest is amazing.